הדובר הבא הוא דוקטור רפאל בן-ארי, גם הוא משפטן, תואר דוקטור מאוניברסיטת בר אילן, תואר ראשון מאוניברסיטת תל אביב, תואר שני במשפט בינלאומי מאוניברסיטת ליידן המפורסמת בהולנד, היה עמית מחקר באוניברסיטת ניו יורק, NYU, אנחנו שומעים בימים האחרונים בהקשרים אחרים על ניו יורק, יועץ משפטי למשלחת ישראל בהאג, ומחבר ספר חשוב שעסק במעמד במשפט הבינלאומי של ארגוני זכויות NGO בינלאומיים. דוקטור בן-ארי, בבקשה.
Dear friends and colleagues, the topics we are discussing today are very complex and controversial indeed, empirically, normatively, and politically. Clearly, they require much more attention and conversation than a one-day symposium can allow. Nevertheless, I would like to introduce some general remarks regarding the normative position of NGOs, which I believe to be significant in outlining the general context required for reviewing the many issues under consideration. Countless NGOs are active in the world today. Their number has grown from 6,000 in 1990 to 26,000 in 1999, and over the past decade has swelled to reach an astonishing 40,000. A majority of these NGOs presume to represent broad public interests and seek to establish international coalitions committed to their promotion. Many are funded by intergovernmental institutions such as the UN and the World Bank, European agencies, particularly the EU and Western European countries, and individuals who identify with their positions. The remarkable flourishing of these organizations and the constant pressure they apply to governments and international bodies in the name of humanitarian goals have given both observers and activists the impression that they constitute a sort of a global civil society, an amorphous, supranational, all-embracing socio-political entity that ostensibly advances democratization processes, protects human rights, and assists peacemaking efforts in regions of conflict. Unfortunately, in some cases, some would say too many, this image has very little to do with reality. In his recent memoirs in 2010, former British Prime Minister Tony Blair admits that over time he came to dislike parts of what he calls the NGO culture. The trouble with some of them, he explains, is that while they are treated by the media as concerned citizens, there are also organizations raising money, marketing themselves, and competing with other NGOs in similar fields. Blair, who recognizes that NGOs have learned to play the modern media game perfectly, suggests that as it's all about impact, NGOs shout louder and louder to get heard, and that balance is not part of the vocabulary. It's all outrage, betrayal, and crisis. Furthermore, they have their own conventional wisdom and tightly defined dogmas, which they define fiercely when challenged, not usually on their merits, but by abusing motives for challenging them. To be sure, the vigorous activism of NGOs contributes to the decentralization of power and hinders the oppressive conduct of states. Many of them take great pains to serve the human cause. Their positive contribution to protecting human rights and improving the lives of the poor and destitute around the world cannot be denied. The commendable activity of Doctors Without Borders and the coalition of organizations behind the International Campaign to Ban Landmines, the ICBL, even won them the Nobel Peace Prize. Movements such as these help populations that have been abandoned by the nation state. They enter a space where law and order do not apply, in which people's lives are exposed to arbitrary violence or forces of nature, and they provide irreplaceable humanitarian aid. However, it is important to remember that these organizations are not elected bodies, are not founded on the principle of representation, and are not in any way accountable to the public. In recent years, these facts have led many international lawyers, among other socio-political scholars and practitioners, to raise serious concerns regarding the legality and legitimacy of NGOs' cross-border activity, and to call into question their ability or willingness to follow the rules of the democratic game. Up until recently, many organizations tried to ground the legitimacy of their activities in the claim that they were serving a higher cause and that they were impartially representing broad public interests. Today, it seems that no one takes these pretensions seriously anymore. Not even the officials of the INGOs themselves, who openly admit to being political actors. Many organizations do not hesitate to publicly take a one-sided position in various conflicts and confrontations, or as one commentator put it recently, paraphrasing Clausewitz, humanitarianism, not just war, has now become the continuation of politics by other means. What is worse, this position is not always consistent with the humanitarian agenda that INGOs purport to represent. A prominent recent example is Amnesty International. In April 2010, it found itself embroiled in an embarrassing scandal due to its connection to Muazzam Beg, a British activist previously imprisoned in Guantanamo Bay and considered a staunch supporter of radical Islam and the Taliban. When Gita Sehgal, head of Amnesty's gender unit, ventured to express reservations about cooperating with Beg, she was suspended from her job. In response to the protests against her suspension, the organization's Secretary General Cordon issued a public response in which he praised Beg and explained that supporting jihad as self-defense was not necessarily antithetical to human rights. Human Rights Watch has also been accused of systematically embracing the Gaddafi Foundation for International Charities and Development, as well as other Arab dictatorships, while ignoring cases of massive human rights violations, such as that of the Libyan dissident Fatih Eliami, who was imprisoned in 2004 and died in 2009 after being held in solitary confinement and tortured. The recent cases of Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch are but a symptom of a wider phenomenon. A number of NGOs are not content with simply expressing sympathy for violence and terrorism and offer their auspices and support to hordes of militant anarchists who do not hesitate to sow violence and destruction. Recalling this context, the violent outbursts directed against the WTO conference in Seattle in 1999, the G8 conference in 2001 in Genoa, which resulted in extensive property damage and even the loss of lives, and the UN's World Conference Against Racism held in 2001 in Durban, which became under the orchestration of a coalition of INGOs, a violent hate faced against Israel and the Jewish people. A recent book issued this year by Médecins Sans Frontières, one of the leading and more respected INGOs, openly admits that one should not fall, and I quote, for the fantasy that humanitarian action can ever exist in some sort of splendid isolation from the context in which it is undertaken, and that all effective humanitarian action is based on negotiating compromises with the relevant political actors, including, of course, insurgent groups. The problem is that this negotiation of compromises involving the daily making of moral judgments under extreme circumstances is made far away from the eyes and of the public and regulators and without parameters or benchmarks against which to judge acceptable from unacceptable compromises. Or, as was put more bluntly by the Dutch journalist Linda Polman, who spent years traveling in war zones, in her book The Crisis Caravan of 2010, scrutinizing the vast industry that has grown up around humanitarian aid. She writes, from the proceeds of their negotiations with INGOs, warring factions feed and arm themselves and buy support. Irrespective of the consequences for the length and ferocity of wars, INGOs and indeed journalists are free to make agreements, pacts, contracts, and deals at their own discretion at village, regional, or national levels. Humanitarian territories, she says, in war zones are free markets where anyone can set out his aid stall as long as he can agree to terms with local power brokers. Striking bargains with parties to conflicts is sometimes referred to as shaking hands with the devil. There are no rules, no limits, and no requirement to have any understanding of the local balance of power or to coordinate with other parties involved, humanitarian agencies included. Experts today already point to the possibility that some NGOs are being widely exploited by terrorist networks as easy points of infiltration into the civic space. Last May, in his statement to the UN Security Council, the chairman of the Council's Counterterrorism Committee noted that the prevention of abuse of NGOs for terrorism purposes is one of the major issues focused upon by the committee. The 2011 Global Survey of the Implementation of Security Council Resolution 1373 of 2001, dealing with combating international terrorism, also recognized the need to guard more effectively against the misuse of NGOs, particularly in the area of financing. But reality is probably worse than such laconic statements may reveal. John Keane, long considered one of the leading authors who has done the most to develop the notion of global civil society for our time, admits that there is growing evidence that global civil society is currently falling under the shadow of global terrorism, which admittedly threatens every corner of global civil society, including its more local network components. Regulation of NGOs' cross-border activities, including humanitarian aid and human rights fact-finding and reporting, and the monitoring of the groups and institutions that fund them, might provide a partial solution to the problem. Attempts to provide NGOs with formal legal status under international law, allowing scrutiny of their cross-border activities, are not new. In fact, since 1912 and throughout the last century, various academic and professional forums continue to put forth drafts of international conventions and reports examining the complex issues involved in such an endeavor. However, these attempts fail to attract any substantive attention. Representatives of the organizations themselves were never particularly enthusiastic about the idea, an understandable response given that formal legal status would force them to maintain transparency and meet other restrictive standards. Most governments, too, expressed reservations primarily because of the fear of strengthening groups suspected of political disloyalty and support and in support of terrorism. As a result, without any widely accepted international mechanism of accreditation and regulation, the loophole in international law has remained, giving NGOs virtually complete freedom of action. Generally, it was acknowledged that the issues involved had to be examined from the point of view of reshaping the structure and organization of the international community, and that the rise of the so-called transnational private sector, characterized by spontaneity and variety, constituted a genuine challenge to the association of nation states. Prominent among the difficult questions that have arisen in the past and remain unresolved until this very day were those of registration, selection, and supervision of eligible organizations. In later years, they reappeared in the form of issues regarding the definition of NGOs and, more recently, the responsibility and accountability. Proven to be politically and legally insoluble hurdles, we still do not even have an agreed-upon definition of the international non-governmental entity under international law. As a result, anyone, anywhere, can establish an NGO and start issuing human rights fact-finding reports that would then be relied upon by the media, or worse, by national courts and international tribunals. Nevertheless, there are still forums that aim to propose a normative framework to facilitate the acquisition of international legal personality by NGOs so that they can become genuine subjects of international law and the euro participants in international law processes side by side with nation states, the original members of the international legal order. Today, against the background of heated discussions about the future of international governance, there is renewed interest in NGOs' legal position. In the age of NGOs and globalization, some international lawyers are encouraged by the hasty invention of models and notions that endeavor to explain the complexities of global interdependence. Being dissatisfied with the fact that NGOs do not fit neatly into existing legal rubrics and doctrines, these scholars might be anxious to apply new concepts borrowed heavily from the fields of political theory, political economy, and in particular international relations, in order to suggest transformative initiatives that would officially incorporate the NGO actor into the international legal order. In this context, legal status is seemingly required to facilitate NGOs' cross-border activities by the provision of rights, privileges, and immunities. This quest is occasionally based on a call for the establishment of a more fair international legal order that would reflect the position and relevance of all significant international actors, including NGOs, thereby legitimizing their voice and ensuring their participation. In most cases, this quest reflects an optimistic view of an angelic community of NGOs, indeed a so-called global civil society, collegially networking to achieve laudable goals and rendering morally merited services for the global public good. This view rests on the assumption that NGOs' involvement makes international decision-making more effective, that NGOs provide significant democratic alternatives to the existing channels of political representation, that they do not act out of self-interest, and that unlike governments, international institutions, and their officials, they are civilized, in agreement, and immune to corruption. However, these assumptions are far from being empirically verified today, and are therefore still based more upon belief than on knowledge. All in all, NGOs have been proven not to care so much about legal status and regulation. They seem to manage with or without these, albeit they care a lot about reputation. Indeed, taking into account that all of the major attempts to regulate the activity of NGOs on an international level have failed, it seems necessary that the media at large, and journalists and reporters in particular, should share in the effort to scrutinize the motives, methods, and in particular the partners and funders of NGOs' cross-border activity. After all, in the case of NGOs, over-regulation can be counterproductive. It can annul the organizational and institutional advantages of spontaneity, variety, and flexibility that characterize NGOs' activity. But this is also exactly the reason why journalists and reporters may prove to be much more effective and successful than international lawyers and regulators can be in playing the significant role of watching the watchdogs. Or, as Pullman states in her epilogue, journalism bears responsibility. Do not automatically approve. Dare to spoil the atmosphere. Ask the NGO's workers questions.